came through the bathroom. Okay, cool. Have you ever seen Saw? You know, horror movie series, life or death traps, little clown puppet riding around on a tricycle? Well, I haven't. But for some reason, Thorpe Park, a theme park in England, has a roller coaster based on those movies, naturally called Saw the Ride, which I think is camp. And this is not me even saying the ride is bad or even so bad as good, but it's obviously meant to be scary. And I'm a total wimp. I cannot handle horror. I think I've seen 2.5 horror movies in my life. And yet this ride doesn't scare me, it never has. So despite its entertainment value, it's clearly not working as intended. So whilst we're waiting here, hear me out, and I can tell you why I think Saw the Ride should be considered part of the camp canon. Part 1. A quick introduction to camp. In 2019, the theme of the world's most prestigious fashion event, the Met Gala, was Camp: Notes on Fashion, which in my opinion is most notable for having created the circumstances that led to this iconic Karlie Kloss tweet, which, let's face it, is camp. YouTuber and actress Liza Koshy was interviewing attendees on the red carpet on behalf of Vogue, and when she asked them to define what camp is, she got some interesting responses.
What does camp mean to you? How would you define camp?
To me, I mean, I think it's about enjoyment and about fun, no judgment, and I don't know, having fun with clothes. I think fashion's supposed to be fun.
Yeah. So. Camp is about being authentic, and I think right now Saint Laurent is what makes me feel the most myself.
I don't know. I honestly, I don't know how to explain that to you. Really, truly, right? That's a very hard thing to explain. Is that what everybody's saying?
Yeah, no, it's hard to define. But what would you define as camp?
I don't know, like woods?
It's easy to make fun of them, but also this term is notoriously hard to define. It's a popular thing on the internet to claim something as camp, or at least the parts of the internet I find myself on, and yet the definition of this term is often vague, and intentionally so. That's part of the allure of camp. You either get it or you don't. So the theme of the Met Gala each year is based off the new costume exhibit at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, with the 2019 exhibit specifically using Susan Sontag's 1964 essay Notes on Camp as a framework. The Met chose Susan Sontag as a focus because she's notable for being one of the first people to give the concept of camp an academic treatment. She was an American writer and philosopher who first gained prominence with her Notes on Camp essay, which is attributed with elevating the concept of camp into mainstream consciousness, with Time magazine talking about camp in reference to Sontag just a few months after she published her essay. Sontag's essay takes the form of a numbered list, paving the way for important 21st century cultures such as BuzzFeed listicles and Jenny Nicholson videos. As someone who isn't an academic, I coped with reading it. It's very dense, but also surprisingly accessible. One thing Sontag states is that due to camp's hard-to-define nature, it works best with examples, with early on in her essay simply listing random things she considers to be camp, such as Swan Lake, Flash Gordon, and the Brown Derby restaurant in LA. So I want to not only use Sontag's essay to argue that Saw the Ride is camp, but also use Saw the Ride as a contemporary example to help illustrate what camp as a concept is. Hopefully I succeed at one or the other of these. Part 2, an overview of Saw the Ride. To talk about Saw the Ride, I have to talk about Thorpe Park, the theme park it resides in. How do I even begin to explain Thorpe Park?
Thorpe Park is flawless.
Thorpe Park is the worst.
It has 7 roller coasters and 4 water rides.
I hear it's building a hypercoaster worth 18 million.
I hear it brainwashes kids into being anti-fracking.
One time Princess Diana visited, and on the flame she looks so pretty.
One time at Friday night someone punched me in the face. It was awesome.
So Thorpe Park is located in Surrey, England, just a short journey away from London. It originally opened in 1975 and operated for decades as a quaint family theme park. However, in 1998, it was bought by Two Swords Group, now known as Merlin Entertainment, best known for owning most of the major UK theme parks, as well as the chain of Legoland theme parks worldwide. Due to a lack of planning restrictions at its location that allowed Merlin to build taller, faster, and louder rides than at the other UK theme parks they owned, the noughties saw Thorpe Park rapidly transform, almost overnight, into debatably the UK's number one theme park destination for thrill seekers. But it is indisputably the UK's number one theme park destination for shipping container enthusiasts. They'll put these bad boys anywhere. They even made a hotel out of them. To make their new branding clear and to appeal to this new audience of teens and young adults, most new additions to the park were based around, in some way, scary, intense, and apocalyptic themes. And also inexplicably in Angry Birds Land. Recent additions to the park include a roller coaster themed to an alien apocalypse, a roller coaster themed to a zombie apocalypse, and a ghost train themed to a demon apocalypse, which I could talk about for hours, so let's save that conversation for another time. Overall, its brand image became edgy, not like the other girls. It's a pick-me theme park. It might sound a bit like I don't like Thorpe Park. I have a strong emotional attachment to it as I grew up with it, and weirdly for a theme park, it grew up with me, going through its angsty teen phase at the same time I did. So I wanted to be clear, I am rooting for Thorpe Park. Always. Even if the shipping container obsession is a bit weird. In 2007, work began on Project Dylan, a major addition to the park set to open in 2009. The idea was to create a horror-inspired roller coaster, starting off in a seemingly abandoned warehouse with a short indoor dark ride section with a few psychological frights before moving into a more conventional outdoor roller coaster. The press release promised that the new ride will offer thrill hunters an experience of a lifetime, creating a darker atmosphere never seen before at Thorpe Park. The ride was designed, approved, and even in the early stages of construction when, in mid-2008, Thorpe Park's marketing team decided they wanted to step things up a gear in terms of getting the ride media coverage, and so started talking to our friends at the movie studio Lionsgate. Sadly, they didn't decide to retrofit this concept into a Twilight roller coaster, and instead decided the ride was now themed to the Saw franchise, a series of films that have been releasing yearly since 2004, with the latest film Saw 5 about to be released when the ride was announced. As you probably know, the premise of these films center around a serial killer, Jigsaw, who sets up gory traps or games that his victims have to escape, testing their will to live through both physical and psychological torture. In many respects, Saw was a natural fit for the direction that Thorpe Park was heading in, scary, edgy, and a little controversial. The material also, in some ways, naturally lends itself to a roller coaster. Being locked in a cage is kind of similar to being strapped into a roller coaster, and Jigsaw's motivation to make his victims feel more alive by putting them through a near-death experience is emotionally similar to that feeling you get after a great roller coaster, that thrill of survival. Previously, I've been really interested in talking about the process of adaption, but here I just want to focus on the experience of the ride itself. Partly because I'm too scared to watch the movies. I'm sorry, I don't want to be psychologically traumatized, just so I can talk about Saw the Ride more accurately. The ride was marketed as the world's first horror movie themed roller coaster, which is debatable, the world's steepest roller coaster, which was true for a few months, and the world's scariest roller coaster. This is important, we will come back to this. Okay, so what does the ride actually entail? Well, the story is that you are in an elaborate trap that Jigsaw has set up, and the ride consists of an indoor roller coaster portion with special effects and show scenes, followed by a longer, lightly themed outdoor roller coaster section. The queue line winds through an abandoned warehouse past various torture devices, as well as screens where Jigsaw appears saying intimidating things. You then get to the ride loading bay, where you can hear Jigsaw saying, "I want to play a game. Here are the rules. Pull down your harness and make sure all loose items, including cell phones, are secured," and other safety instructions. It's possibly my favorite detail in the entire experience. You strap into your ride vehicle and round the first corner where Billy, the iconic puppet from the Saw movies, appears and says something very quietly that I've never been able to quite make out, but I imagine is really ominous. But it's Thorpe Park, so maybe he's just talking about his love of shipping containers, who knows? The car rounds a corner and starts heading towards some swinging axes, with the ride taking a sharp, steep drop to dodge these. The vehicle then slowly passes through a tunnel where compressed air mimics darts being thrown at the rider, followed by a heartline roll over a naked corpse which sprays blood, aka water, at the rider, before moving outside the building, and round a corner where they stop before a countdown clock and a screen, which Jigsaw appears on and says, "Game over." The vehicle then ascends up the lift hill vertically before plunging into the 100 degree drop, dodging some twirling blades overhead. The ride then goes into the proper coaster section, and as someone who isn't a fully fledged coaster enthusiast, I lack the vernacular to properly describe it. Thankfully, the ever reliable Wikipedia has a description, which says that the ride then enters an Immelmann loop, followed by a tight overbank corner and airtime hill. The on-ride photos are taken as the cars rise to the left into a set of brakes. This is followed by a steep drop into a dive loop, and the ride ends with a bank turn into the final brake run. That was total gibberish to me. Did that mean anything to you? At the end of the ride, Jigsaw can be heard saying, "Congratulations, you are still alive. People are so ungrateful to be alive, but not you, not anymore." As the ride vehicle moves past Billy, casually sat amongst a bunch of disassembled test dummies, before you exit the vehicle. And there's a sign on the side of the vehicle that you can't exit that says, "No escape, this side," which I think is really cute. So you exit the building via a stairwell, but there is one final message from Jigsaw, who appears on a screen to say, "The games have just begun." And that's the ride. Part 3. Saw the ride, looking Camp right in the eye. Sontag's notes on Camp is comprised of 58 notes, so in order to focus my analysis, I'm going to look at 4 key points from Sontag's list in order to talk about in relation to Saw the Ride. Number 3. Not only is there a Camp vision, a Camp way of looking at things, Camp is as well a quality discoverable in objects and the behaviour of persons. There are campy movies, clothes, furniture, popular songs, novels, people, buildings. This distinction is important. True, the camp eye has the power to transform experience, but not everything can be seen as camp. It's not all in the eye of the beholder. So I think it's important to establish that I'm not simply looking at Saw the Ride in a camp way. Sure, it is a lens of interpretation, but I can't just walk around Thorpe Park like some terminally online Twitter user pointing at random rides and saying, "Samurai is camp, Stealth is camp, Tidal Wave is..." Maybe Tidal Wave is camp. I'm not just picking a ride at random and arguing it's camp for sport. This is something I genuinely believe has inherently camp qualities that are discoverable and discussable. Ultimately, I can't single-handedly make any ride camp. Number 55. Camp taste is above all a mode of enjoyment, of appreciation, not judgment. Camp is generous. It wants to enjoy. It only seems like malice, cynicism, or if it is cynicism, it's not a ruthless, but a sweet cynicism. Camp taste doesn't propose that it is in bad taste to be serious. It doesn't sneer at someone who succeeds in being seriously dramatic. What it does is define a success in certain passionate failures. So as enjoyable as Saw the Ride is, it's clearly failing at its core ambitions. Going back to the marketing campaign for this ride, this was pitched as the world's scariest roller coaster, and yet this ride isn't particularly scary, at least in terms of the theming and dark ride elements beyond the coaster itself. And whilst the world's scariest roller coaster is typical Merlin marketing hyperbole setting impossible to reach expectations, if you look at the ride itself, the emotions it wants to evoke are fairly clear. Not only is it themed to a popular horror movie franchise, but uses it to tell a story specifically about putting you through an experience so terrifying you learn to appreciate the gift of life again. The ride should feel dangerous and foreboding and scary to the extent that when you finish and have survived the experience, there's a sense of relief. But the ride, at least in the dark ride driven first half, never creates a real sense of danger. This is more successful in the roller coaster driven second half of the ride, particularly this escalating sense of tension building towards the 100 degree drop. You round the corner and sit there below a countdown clock while Jigsaw says his scary little things before what I find the scariest part of the entire experience: ascending upwards vertically. Now, the lift hill is not only a requirement of most roller coasters to create the kinetic energy to drive the roller coaster, but is often used to slowly create a sense of anticipation at the start of a ride, gradually building as you climb higher and higher. Saw the Ride has a vertical lift hill, which is really effective in the way it creates this rising sense of dread in the way a traditional lift hill does, whilst also being quite a scary experience in and of itself. The feeling of not being in control, that slight discomfort, a fear you might slip out your seat. I find this terrifying no matter how many times I do it. I hate it. In a good way. I was surprised when watching videos of this ride to see it only takes about 10 seconds to ascend the vertical lift hill, because it feels a lot longer when you're experiencing it due to how unsettling and frankly terrifying it is. Here the gap between the intent of the designers and the impact of their creation is small. The ride is trying to scare us, and at least in my opinion, doing so very effectively. However, if we compare to the indoor first half of the ride, we can see how this doesn't manage to create the same sense of fear and dread. At the start of the ride, we round the corner and have a show scene with Billy on his tricycle, and this really should be ramping up the tension. However, there's no real build up to his appearance, we can barely hear what he's saying, and then we move on quite swiftly from this moment. Moving towards the swinging blades in the next scene is a bit more effective, and the drop in the dark to escape them is quite successful, although more through a sense of surprise than any mounting sense of anticipation. the time between the rider rounding the corner and seeing the blades ahead, and then dropping to escape them, is only 3 seconds, which is barely enough time to register what's taking place, let alone build up any fear through this anticipation. Compare this to, say, Disney's Expedition Everest, where, spoiler, the time between seeing the broken track in front of you and then rolling backwards is a solid 20 seconds. This doesn't mean this first section of Saw the Ride isn't entertaining. I would argue it's my favorite part. These elements spark joy and provide spectacle, but they don't scare, so the gap between the intent and the impact is much larger. It's important to recognize that this ride isn't failing through a sense of laziness or careless design. This ride is, especially by UK theme park standards, a blockbuster ride pulling out all the stops. It feels accurate to describe it in terms of being a passionate failure, one that's very enjoyable, but in an unintended way. Now, the word failure, I feel like is quite a strong, harsh word to describe this ride, so I think it's important to emphasize and clarify exactly what aspect the ride is failing at. Number 23. In Naive, or Pure Camp, the essential element is seriousness. A seriousness that fails. Of course, not all seriousness that fails can be redeemed as camp. Only that which has the proper mixture of the exaggerated, the fantastic, the passionate, and the naive. So Sontag distinguishes between two types of camp. Camp which knows itself to be camp, which is ironic and knowing, and then pure camp, which is naive and earnest, with Sontag arguing that the latter is more satisfying. Sontag defines pure camp's essential element as a seriousness that fails. So when I talk about Saw the Ride failing, I'm talking about it failing to be a serious, scary experience. The ride's value in part comes from this failed seriousness that brings the entertainment value, like the subject of a One Direction song so blissfully unaware of what makes it so very special. Like when you're about to board the vehicle and you can hear Jigsaw saying, "I want to play a game. Here are the rules. Pull down your harness and make sure all loose items are secured." That's camp. Or when Billy cycles up on his little tricycle and mumbles something quietly at the start of the ride. That's camp. Or especially when you do a corkscrew slowly over a naked groaning body with fat cakes that squirts blood at you. That's camp. At this moment, I've been sat on this ride next to total strangers who've turned around and laughed with me in the aftermath. It's something that provokes such a strong level of joy that strangers, not only that, British strangers, engage and share in the experience together. And this instinctive response isn't based in anything ironic, it's a sincere enjoyment. It's fun, it's over the top, it's iconic, even if it's not deeply horrifying in the way it maybe should be. But it would be much less fun if it was intentionally trying to be a silly, campy ride, with all the scares delivered with an ironic, knowing wink. I don't think the ride would work in the same way if it was based off the Scary Movie franchise, for example. But Saw the Ride trying to be the world's scariest roller coaster and failing only heightens the pure camp appeal. Number 25. The hallmark of camp is the spirit of extravagance. Camp is a woman walking around in a dress made of 3 million feathers. In camp, there is often something démesuré in the quality of the ambition, not only in the style of the work itself. This combination of ambition and extravagance is a key aspect of not only what makes the ride camp, but also what makes it great. Saw the Ride is a woman wearing 3 million feathers, or a guy up high wearing 3,000 sequins. At the time, this was Thought Park's most expensive ride, and it does feel like they threw the kitchen sink at it. It's so ambitious, bringing together many separate aspects, combining a major coaster with dark ride elements and a Hollywood IP, but also reaching far beyond what the given budget actually stretches to, whilst also trying to be the world's scariest roller coaster. It wants to be so much more than just a roller coaster. It absolutely is. It's definitely greater than the sum of its parts. It feels like a more complete experience because of all these different elements coming together, though this is partly because it resides in a park where the average coaster lasts about 30 seconds. Its appeal is in its excess, and all the wild, exaggerated elements, the giant swinging blades, the ludicrous safety spiel, getting sprayed in the face while doing a corkscrew over a naked body, all make it feel so special. It's a classic. A camp classic, some might say. Is it just me, or they've been in there a really long time? Hello? It's empty. Anyway, I really need to pee, so I'll catch you in a bit. Okay, cool.